Next we have is we're going to try and do a fishbowl type panel where we want to kind of get the answer. A lot of people have been asking, like, what's the future JavaScript framework? Like, what should we, if you're building a new app today, what should we be thinking about? Which one to pick? What recommendations we have? And I don't know, as John pointed out, if there is a right or wrong answer. But what we would try and do with this panel is try and see what different people have opinions about and what they think, you know, you should use Ember, you should use this, you should use that, and here's the reason behind why I would suggest you should use this. So we're going to open it up. Anybody from the audience can jump in and kind of start giving their perspective. But I would request if four people can come up and seed this to start with the discussion, and then more people can come in and we can rotate people through this. So do we have any four volunteers who want to come up and try and take a shot at answering what is the future of JavaScript web frameworks?
I'll.
Good, two.
I'll do it.
John, three.
Sure. I'm already mic'd, this is so easy. We're actually going to do karaoke now?
Yeah.
Setting the rules, one chair is empty. If anybody else from the audience wants to answer, they come take the chair. One of you will have to leave, and that continues at any given point in time. One chair is empty for someone to come and take the chair. All right? Give it a fight.
What? Oh, so we're... Yeah. How's this start? So I just
you
make...
your opinion, and I disagree with it.
Oh, well... Okay. I thought we were friends.
No.
So me and John think very similarly. So I consider the future of JavaScript to be isomorphic JS, obviously. So rendering the state of your application on the server side using Node.js, and hopefully sharing some of the logic that you've built for your application across the server and on the client. There isn't currently a lot of frameworks out there that provide this sort of support. We're getting there. Ember's working on it. Tom Dale wrote a blog post a couple years ago about progressive enhancement and sort of referenced the work that they were going to do with Ember. But yeah, the future of JavaScript frameworks is probably this kind of work, this kind of logic is going to get done for you, so you won't even have to think about it. There won't be a server anymore. You'll probably just wire up endpoints to an API that's going to be running Go or Python or something that's super performant for actually crunching data, and that'll be an API. And then your web server will be in Node because you'll be able to share the logic of your application on the server.
So, one of the implications there is there's going to be a web server. Actually, so the web server is the thing that serves out HTML and CSS, which is going to be your Node.js app, which is isomorphic. And you're going to have the backend server, which is going to use the same APIs that the Node application uses, as well as your React application uses, so that it can be isomorphic to do that. So, okay.
So, wait, do you agree with me? You have the stage.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. So, yeah, I do agree with you, but that... So that's like a shift right now. So you're gonna have all these problems with. So one of the things that I face is the Node.js app currently is doing all these nice things with the database and things like that. Now I have to write an API endpoint as well as the isomorphic rendering part.
Should be doing that anyways.
Yeah, I know. I'm lazy.
You should be abstracting your data from here. Yeah.
But I think this is a step in the right direction because a lot of the ClojureScript community around OOM is also going in the same direction. React, of course, has been the pioneer of this. And I mean, there are newer languages around functional programming like PureScript, which are also trying to do the same thing. So I clearly agree that's the way forward. And I mean, it's going to be interesting going forward. I don't disagree, actually.
Yeah, you don't disagree. Yeah.
Well, I do actually disagree. So I see JavaScript moving into a future where number crunching isn't just, you know, the property of Python and R and Go and all these other languages. But what I also see is, you know, all these server-based applications running inside the browser using platforms like Wasm or Native Client. There's going to be a time when machine learning will not just be a server-side thing anymore. It's going to be running within Chromebooks, which today seems impossible, sounds impossible, but it's going to happen because we are moving in that direction. So yeah, I do disagree with you over there.
I think this is going to eventually come up to the stage where the reasons why we disagree are because we all see different niches of the future, because the future is actually gigantic, because the world is gigantic.
And JavaScript is eating all the programmers.
And JavaScript.
And programming.
It's true. I wonder though, so I would have not, especially now since WebAssembly, although again, very buzzwordy and extremely new and bleeding edge, I would be much more of the belief today, maybe not 6 months ago, that it's not going to be Native Client that does something like that, but rather when WebAssembly does diverge from whatever is currently supportable and is performant enough to do that in a way that doesn't, we don't care anymore because we're not using, either not using browsers that old or we're not using pagers that old. I don't know where that's going to end up somehow in the world. But that for me is going to be the future with respect to performant calculations in a browser, not Mackle.
So the one awesome thing about the JavaScript community is that, so there's goal A. There's going to be three different ways, three different projects, three different teams who are trying to get to the same goal in probably, you know, using different methodologies, different thought processes. So at the end of the day, someone is going to end up reaching there. We just don't know who. And that is something that is probably missing from a lot of other different ecosystems. So that is one thing that hopefully is going to stay. So for instance, you know, the whole debate between Native Client and WebAssembly, well, it's two different ways to solve the same problem, but somebody is going to get there. And at the end of the day, it doesn't matter who gets there, somebody gets there.
JavaScript will get there.
Yeah.
Firefox OS.
Always bet on JS.
Always bet on JS.
On building their solutions, you know, for analytics, big data stuff, Microsoft. I mean, will they see that as a vision where you are undercutting their whole economy?
Are you talking about like proprietary logic or something like that?
Yeah.
You can still abstract away, you know, if you're talking about a game or you're doing something interesting with data on the server side, you can still lock that down, that logic. But when we're talking about the future of software, I imagine, and this is something I've said for a long time, I imagine that all of our devices will eventually just be Windows to the web. An application is just a web app, because it's just going to get to that point. JavaScript is the most ubiquitous language in the world. It's in every one of our devices. There's a JavaScript engine in every one of our devices. And it's got one of the most performant, you know, like the JVMs have been, you know.
It's funny, no, JVMs actually mean JavaScript VMs. It used to mean something else.
Yeah, yeah. But
JVM still means JVM.
Yeah. But essentially, they like these enterprise companies or these big companies need to find new ways of offering something to their users or their customers. And usually it's insights, analytical insights, and there's something proprietary about that. So they have to get kind of progressive about their business model. They can't just sell software anymore.
But they aren't doing that, you know, right? I mean, Microsoft is not doing that.
No, and they're falling behind.
But I also think that the
But
the
they
markets,
still make billions.
The markets that we are talking about, this is where the future is just gigantic. The markets we're talking about are completely distinct. The people who are going to Microsoft to build, or working with C# and .NET to build a web form application out of the box are not the same people that are going to be considering, one, the development team, and two, the costs of a node application that has isomorphic JS that's building a React application. These are not the same markets at all. So I don't know if I feel like they would ever think, or at least not in the near future, that we were tromping on their toes. Because they're not, the same people aren't looking.
But, I mean, one instance is PayPal is moving all of their Java-based app sites to Node.js. I mean, and you know, Douglas JavaScript Crockford works for them. So that's one. I know for a fact SAP, I don't know, anybody from SAP here, Bangalore? SAP Labs, Bangalore? So I know for a fact they are doing a lot of stuff with Node now and moving some of their application server pieces onto Node from Java, actually. So.
Well, it also depends on how far in the future we're looking, because eventually we'll all just be cyborgs and robots, and so it won't even matter, the web.
I was thinking like 100 years, maybe?
100, yeah, 100 years, yeah. I mean, no. Elon Musk thinks that there's going to be artificial intelligence in
you, you can become a cyborg now, all you have to get a pacemaker or something.
Yeah, true, a pacemaker.
That still makes you a cyborg.
I think the pace of change around us is so fast that I think it's impossible to look 1 year beyond from now, in my opinion. Like, in 1 year, we don't know what's going to come up. At least that's the kind of state I live in. So I was thinking future as in maybe the next 1 year. If I'm planning to start a new product development, what are the technologies I should be looking at?
My choice right now would be React and Node.js and isomorphic stuff. I like Ember, but yeah.
We agree too much up here.
Yeah.
I disagree. It's gonna be Ember and Fastboot. I actually do think that's.
And true. Glimmer.
And Glimmer. Yeah.
Glimmer, I would actually go for Famous. I would look at Famous. I think Famous is the future of really interactive UIs that look good and perform really well on different devices. And because Famous and Angular are so well connected, I think Angular is something, even if you're into React, Angular is something you really need to keep an eye on. And well, Node for backend, that I suppose that goes without saying.
Can we have Alexis to talk about why he disagrees with everyone here?
I agree too much.
You agree too much.
We need disagreement on stage.
One point I have to make for his statement. Microsoft is changing its strategies. In 2016, SQL Server 2016, they are supporting JSON. They are building document DB, which actually support JSON. So it is changing its strategies towards the JavaScript, and corporates are changing as per their needs.
Hey guys. I guess they wanted some different opinions. Sorry, I got caught up in the dessert line out there.
What?
There's
dessert. I gotta go.
Before I say anything, could you restate the original question? I was like walking up here in a hurry.
The future of JavaScript.
What is the future of
JavaScript? Why you disagree with them, basically? That's the question.
Well,
oh, I have a way I disagree.
I can.
Yeah, so my original question was, what's the future of JavaScript frameworks? But I think the panel decided to expand it a little bit more,
it's
which is cool
future,
with me.
It's now the future of Java. It's now actually the future of web development. We've been talking way further than JavaScript.
Yeah,
we're basically saying stop writing Ruby, start writing Node and isomorphic JF. That's basically what you're saying.
Yeah,
and I will, yeah, you take a more stronger view on that than
oh,
I
do. I'm hardcore, yeah.
I don't know that I can, I'm going to give you an answer, but I'm not sure it's the answer everyone's going to want to hear. You can't really state one framework is going to win out over the other. I say that from, if you were here for the CanJS talk, we showed the graph of all the different frameworks, and I hear this argument, this debate, you know, what is better, CanJS or this? And I've heard that debate for the last 9 years. That's how long we've been around. It really comes down to, there's a lot of frameworks. There's going to be more frameworks tomorrow and next year. There's going to be a bunch of frameworks coming out for whatever reasons, whatever different purposes they're trying to solve. A lot of them found on this concept of theory and academia. This is what we would like to solve. The only thing we provide, really, we try to do with our framework is, what are the problems you're facing practically today? Really, what I see throughout the frameworks is a convergence versus, we're all going to have different opinions, but we've already seen a lot of the frameworks start moving in the same direction. When the web component spec came through, immediately we all said, hey, there's a declarative approach to how you can throw modules together on the web. Everybody has their own declarative syntax these days. CanJS has components, Ember has components, Angular is really only components, and React has JSX. So we all have a declarative way to approach things at this point. But even behind the scenes, little by little, it's really, I agree with John's statement a second ago, it's approaching web development moving forward as opposed to picking the winner, if that makes sense. I know that's a very gray answer for you, so.
Fair enough.
So I've thought about something that I sort of, I don't know if I disagree with, but I think is a nuance that might be worthwhile. So there are situations now, mostly for short-term applications that I have been much more interested in not having a backend at all and looking at the parses and what's the other one called?
Firebase.
Firebase, parses and Firebases of the world. And I've used parse, not Firebase. But I think that they will become much more ubiquitous like Heroku is now, that right now they are not, such that we won't have to necessarily have a backend for most of our applications. Especially as front-end developers who don't necessarily want to delve into Ruby, Python, not even Node necessarily.
So I'm very keen to know, I don't want to see this jQuery as an API, I want to see it as a language. I'm keen to know whether there is any library that touches the file system directly with the jQuery. And another thing is, I want to touch directly the database like SQL, MS SQL, PostgreSQL direct with the jQuery. Is there any chance?
The question was, is there a JavaScript library to directly access the database?
With jQuery.
Well, I mean, I'm sure there's a few jQuery core contributors' faces I see around the room. Maybe choosing the right tool for the job comes into question here, because jQuery at its core is to manipulate the DOM. It's a simple library to help us change how things get on a web page versus how something comes in a database.
Actually, to do these things, JavaScript will also be helpful, but we built an API like jQuery.
Yeah, flip the mic around.
So when you say API like jQuery, do you mean like a fluent interface over adding query pieces of query?
Yeah, something like
that. So there are ORM or query helping libraries that allow you to, not with jQuery, but allow you to chain things that look like jQuery.
Okay, from the web perspective, PHP is directly touching to the database and file systems. Can we integrate PHP and jQuery and in the roadmap, directly jQuery will only touch the database like
so
that?
Node.js will allow you to do that.
It will allow the file system also?
Yes. So in Node.js, once installed on your system, you can consider like the Ruby executable or the PHP executable that can interact with, it can make system calls and interact with your machine.
Only JavaScript will helpful, like.
All right, I'm sorry I need to cut this out because this is going in a completely different direction. I thought you wanted to contribute something to what was discussed, not go in a completely different direction. Okay. All right, so I'm sorry. But we do want to continue on this. If people have specific questions about a particular framework and why it's better, and you want to talk about that, I think, sorry about that, but that's what the focus of this panel should be.
Yeah, that question was asked, and I think like four hands shot up at the same time.
So you talked about the front end data. What are your top three offline databases would you recommend?
Are you talking about Parse and Firebase?
Something like that.
To be honest,
like
I only
index,
know Parse
index
and Firebase.
DB, there are some Levinod.
They all integrate with all the frameworks.
Can you just repeat the question?
So the question was, do we recommend any one of these third-party or these cloud storage APIs that you can essentially store your data in the cloud, and you just pay a fee and you're not handling any of the data, which is awesome. So like Firebase and Parse, there's some other ones like that. I think PubNode.
I think he was asking more about the in browser, like IndexedDB sort of thing. You should check out PouchDB. PouchDB.
Yes.
PouchDB is like a CouchDB thing. All the queries and stuff like that work there. And it's a good fit for in browser databases.
Yeah. Okay, that's good.
That's actually also the only one I know.
I have one word. Boo. I don't. I'm personally not a big fan of the web component spec, and we. I know this will probably bring up debate. I don't like the shadow DOM necessarily, and I think that there's a lot of work that was gone into the standards bodies like the web component spec that Google helped work on, and the Polymer team has been essential to that. I don't like it for a number of reasons. I don't like web components for a number of reasons. One of the biggest ones is obviously shadow DOM. And essentially the problems it solves, they're not problems. If you have problems with encapsulation of your JavaScript code right now, you're doing a bad job as a developer. And if you have problems with style encapsulation, again, you're doing a bad job as a developer. So I think that for us to trade the ecosystem of jQuery plugins to go towards web components, it doesn't solve any problems. So it's kind of whatever. Polymer 1.0, I mean, it's just another framework. I think it comes with a lot of really useful tools. So I do think that people will get use out of it. The implementation, though, of web components, I don't like. I'm not sure if anybody else.
As far as the implementation goes, I'm a little indifferent with Polymer. What I do find really interesting is you have two major frameworks within the same company of Polymer and Angular, and the teams do communicate with each other. Angular takes a lot of Polymer's lead because Polymer eventually, at some point, there's going to need to be some convergence between the two. If you're from the Rails community, this was a big thing with Rails 2.0 and MERB, for those who really want to go back in the day. And it's going to be that kind of concept. I find that's going to be interesting with how they're going to merge the APIs. Maybe I'm a little bit more go with the flow. I don't think too much about whether or not I dislike specs. Maybe I should develop opinions. I just kind of do what I'm told, I guess, in that respect. But I find that more interesting. What is the future of Polymer and Angular?
Yeah, they've added a lot of plugins or essentially a lot of the material design components they've added and given you for free. So it's kind of like a jQuery UI competitor almost. And again, the fact that there's the Angular team, there's the Polymer team, and then there's DevRel, although they do talk to each other, they do have different opinions on certain things. The DevRel team will tell you that you should be concerned about page load performance and time to glass, and that mobile is really important. And the best way to get that optimal performance is to do server-side rendering and not to have a single page app, right? And rendering in the client. So that completely goes against Angular's current implementation. You know, wait until the packet, render the view in once you can execute JavaScript in the client side. Those are completely different opinions. So Angular sort of doesn't care, right? They sort of don't care about this thing that the DevRel team says that developers care about time to glass and it's better user experience if you can ship HTML right away. So this goes back into the isomorphic sort of ideology that hopefully eventually we'll be able to basically just shipping HTML code from our JavaScript applications that were executed on the server side.
Actually, this is on a tangent to mobile and this thing, but very interesting. So I think one of the things that's missing in the frameworks or library space, or actually more in the framework space, is to let us build good offline-enabled mobile web apps, right? Right now, you could pretty much, write your manifest yourself. You could do all the offline and all that stuff, but it makes it really hard. There's a lot of boilerplate to do. To get it right. I think React is a good first step where you can do isomorphic rendering, you can pretty much get all the data locally. You need to have a good sync adapter. I think something like GraphQL could help in having the data in the same format on the client as well as the server so that you could kind of make sense of the queries both on the server and the client side. So those things are in the right direction, but I think I mean, if there is to be a framework which would drastically change a mobile web app development, I think something like that would be the thing.
That's actually a really good statement, and here's my controversial point of the day. I think this is more, this is a huge impact. This is one of the biggest things I think I noticed when I first came to India. I know right now there's tons of commercials, YouTube, now with offline feature, that kind of stuff. It's hard when you prioritize development in frameworks. I'm gonna just recite some of the sentiment from my colleagues. We're not headed towards a world of less connectivity. We're headed towards a world of more connectivity. So asking a major company or team, especially smaller teams that are building open source frameworks to focus on offline, it's gonna be a struggle. You're talking about, you know, CanJS was in development for a long time, Angular was in development for 4 years, 5 years at this point. I had Wi-Fi on the plane to get here. And as we go forward, even India's huge infrastructure here in Bangalore over the last like 5 years in terms of connectivity, offline is starting to becoming less and less of an issue. There was a great, it was a fun article in TechCrunch in the last month talking about Americans who were testing their software, their beta mobile software app in Seoul, South Korea. And they said, hey, how do you view this in mobile? And the response was, where else would you view it? Because they were not used to the concept that Americans are even used to, where we have to check something on the desktop because maybe you don't have Wi-Fi connectivity on your phone because they're so connected. So it's, if you know the future is connectivity, how do you prioritize offline when it's a shrinking space, basically?
I had been to the US, and I think US has more connectivity issues than India has, actually. So I couldn't get phone signals in my apartment. I didn't have Wi-Fi, but I mean, you get the point. The point is, it is not about, it's the first app launch experience, actually, right? I mean, that's why these apps are amazing, because they launch, they show some data, and then they can connect and they can get the other data, right? I mean, there's always this latency which kills you. Now, with mobile, I mean, given that the mobile web experience is pretty bad now, mostly because of the ads and overlays and things like that, but even if you have to build an app, I think offline becomes extremely important because you want to be able to quickly display something, have those actions that are, I mean, I'm sure there'll be connectivity, I'm sure there'll be all these things, but the first pixel to render has to be really fast.
So I'm definitely biased by not really understanding statistics very well and being in the subway population of New York where I am offline for a lot of time. But for me, the difference would not be that I'm always online or offline, but rather I don't want to pay for things when I am on, I don't want to have to pay for so much data. And I want to be able to cache everything I want to cache. So like I
service
find
worker.
Sure. I find apps that let me do a lot of things while I'm on Wi-Fi to then be able to go off and do things better. And you're right, I don't think there are any, I don't know about should frameworks prioritize this or not, but I would love, like you said, to have a framework out there that out of the box did some of these things for me. That would be great.
I think someone had their question, been waiting for a time, but yeah.
What do you think about future of Meteor.js, which has like front-end, back-end, and database management?
Meteor.js?
Yeah.
So socket connections?
They
so.
Got $20 million in funding or something. They're yeah. good. They're totally good. I don't have a very strong actual opinion.
I also don't really have a strong. I used to think that there was. I used to have a concern about the socket connections, and not so much anymore. Is there a max? Do you know when you jQuery folks? Do you know if there's a limit on the socket connections? I think maybe they would have to, or they must have to do some work, because you. Imagine you have a website that has got like crazy load balancing on it. You probably have to distribute like the number of node servers. I'm wondering.
There are WebSocket gateways and things like that that are supposed to solve this problem, paid ones.
Okay, so my only concern was socket connections, but Meteor seems pretty interesting project. But again, with Meteor.js, they don't ship HTML. They wait until you can create a socket connection and then.
They also don't use NPM, if I remember correctly. They have their own package manager, which is different. Does anyone in this room use Meteor?
I have been trying.
Okay.
I have worked a little bit.
Cool. So awesome. We don't
I
have.
Mean, I would be excited to hear from you if you want to.
Come over if you have some experience to share.
Well, I've just developed a to-do app. So I just wanted to know, like, how is the future of it?
Might be the wrong crowd to ask.
I would say, again, if they implement all the things that I talked about originally, that my original opinion on what we need, if literally there's a framework that encapsulates that whole process for you and you don't even have to think about time to glass and you don't have to think about shipping HTML for the initial page load and then like essentially something that just like encapsulates the whole experience of a web app, then.
So one thing I didn't like about Meteor was MongoDB, actually. So it has this opinion about using MongoDB
right.
as your primary storage. I think you should check out ShareJS, actually. They are a little more friendly to the rest of the node packages. They are on NPM. You can actually use a part of ShareJS as a part of your bigger Express project. And they use the same operational transform library that the Google Wave team initially wrote. And it's very performant, actually. So I would recommend ShareJS over Meteor.
Yeah.
I'd give it a shot. I mean, give it a try.
Yeah.
I think you would like that more than sure.
Yeah, thanks.
Actually, I'm just curious to kind of quickly go around and see how many JavaScript frameworks people have actually used. Just kind of get a count of the frameworks that you know we have here in the room.
You mean the ones that we used last month, this month, or overall?
Anytime. Anytime. Like what JavaScript frameworks, not libraries, JavaScript frameworks particularly, you've used in the past or you're currently using. You know, let's kind of try and get a quick count. We'll go around, we'll see how many people.
I've used only one framework, Ember. That's it.
Ember,
I think everything,
okay.
else is, everything else has been libraries, because even Angular, I consider it to be a library than a framework. jQuery is a library.
I think we're grouping them all together, but I agree with you.
Yeah.
Angular, though, is, I mean, they do claim in some places it's a framework, but I agree with you that it's more of a library than a framework. But anyway, let's say.
Durandal is a framework. Durandal is a framework. So I've used Durandal. It's built on Knockout. So I've used that. Yeah, I've known two frameworks because that has an opinion about how you structure it with the required JS and your routing and stuff like that. So I've used Durandal and this thing.
Two.
You want me to list them?
What frameworks have you used?
I think TenJS goes without saying. Angular, Ember. Oh my God. We use Durandal a little bit, Backbone. I mean, we have to use them because we compete with them. So, but yeah, it's good to know, it's wise to know the ways of one's adversary, but it's good to just see what other APIs are look like and what are people doing, why are they choosing those choices. So we try to be objective when we're bringing this stuff to light. And if there's a good idea, if it's a good idea, we're gonna, you know, we're gonna want to put it in CanJS as well. So we try to be as diverse as possible.
So would you say CanJS is a library or a framework? Neither.
I mean, yeah, it really is just semantics. It's a tool to help you complete your job. If you want to call it potato, that's totally cool too.
Potato, okay.
That's your new tagline.
You didn't CanJS. Say
CanJS is potato.
Potato of the web. I know, I'm really good at marketing, right?
Yeah.
I've used Backbone, is like my primary go-to. I've done Ember and Angular as well. I think I might have a long time ago like spun up a Meteor JS demo, but just to check that out. But yeah, that's it.
John?
So in terms of what I use on a regular basis, it is Ember, Angular, Backbone, React. I suppose. I'm gonna gloss over the, we're all gonna go with potato here. But I've also used a lot of YUI 2.8 and 3.0. Not recently, but I have. XJS, pre-whatever Sentra took over. Not recently. And then there are dozens of what I very affectionately call frameworks, which are John Paul's fancy things on top of jQuery and Prototype, which had a lot of bugs, but I was still very proud of at the time. So I'm going to call that.
So the count is 15 so far from what I've heard from all of you guys. Is there anything else that these guys did not cover?
jQuery Mobile.
jQuery
what?
jQuery Mobile.
Mobile?
Oh, jQuery. Yeah. I did that once.
That's 16. Anything else? Dojo, 17.
Oh, yeah.
Flight, Dojo. 18. Motools.
Prototype is the best.
18, prototype, 19.
What, Scriptaculous, Motools. What are we talking about, libraries? Or what?
Yeah, it kind of went off into libraries land.
And Socket.io.
And I just thought it would be good to bump up the count.
So, okay, this is another question. So what, according to you, is a library versus what is a framework? I mean, what qualifies as a framework?
He said it's potato, so.
So I different, the way I differentiate this
what
is not
qualifies
the word
as a library, framework, and a potato?
For me, I don't try to differentiate between library and framework because the argument just goes on forever. I care about opinionatedness or not because I prefer, that my personal preference is opinionated things. Like I enjoy Rails, I enjoy Ember because I do not have, personally, because I do not have to make decisions about the stupid things.
You don't like coding, is what you're saying.
I don't like coding.
You don't like development.
I'm lazy.
I don't
want to
write.
Like yeah. Developing.
Why are people so scared of writing code? Like, that's the problem. It's like, I want a one method that says build website and execute that, and it's like, does everything. You gotta, like, why are you so concerned? Like, at some point, you're gonna have to write the things that wire stuff together.
I think being in a jQuery conf, I think it should be dollar this dot build website.
There we go. New method, dollar this build website. There you go.
And I came up with that by looking at Stack Overflow, actually.
The thing about programmers is that we are lazy, and that's why we don't want to do too much work, right, John?
Exactly. If there was a dollar.build website for client or product, and the computer would talk to the product manager, you would take it every time.
If they did it properly, sure. But there's so many caveats to web development, accessibility, and so many things.
I mean, I agree.
So the reason I asked this question is because, I mean, I do agree that opinions are a way in which I distinguish a framework from a library. But I lean towards using a loose set of libraries and a kind of a common way or a good way to piece them together. Because what that helps is that you can take out pieces of the library and then kind of evolve it separately. Now, the problem that I have with the Ember approach. I like Ember, so I've done stuff on Ember. I like the way in which their components work. I like the way in which the computer properties work. I like all of that stuff. And I like the fact that they do routing and controllers and stuff like that. But the trouble I have with that is, frameworks tend to go on their own path of this package management. Meteor is a good example of that, actually. So they have their own package management. They don't play well with NPM. So does, I mean, Ember does pretty much the same kind of things, right? I mean, they have their own build system and their own
it's called NIH, not invented here syndrome.
Yeah,
NIH.
It makes it very difficult. So the point is you come from a big frameworks perspective, and Yehuda has been very proud of the fact that Ember is a framework and it's not a library, and why he does that. I get that, but I think that's kind of a wrong thing to do, especially because Ember data can be quite useful outside Ember everywhere else if it were available as an NPM module, because that does exactly what the offline enabled capabilities can do and all that kind of stuff, but it's tied very deeply into Ember.
That's why frameworks are dangerous. You need modules.
Yeah, we had the same opinion. When we wrote JavaScript MVC, this was a while ago, we were the same way. It was like our way or the highway. Around 2009, 2010, we started to realize, I think it was when we started bringing on more people to Batovi, we had the same thing. We wanted to break, certain parts were useful, we wanted to use them with different pieces. So we broke it out into many different modules. So you can use them piecemeal, CanJS. I think we even, like our tagline, we call it a library, but we are unopinionated, or we try to be, because we want to provide you tools. If you want to use Can Model, if you guys were in the CanJS talk, you saw the quick abstraction demo I had. If you want to use Can Model with React's view layer, cool. You know, we want to give you the tools, and however you want to break them apart, that's totally up to you. Most of what we do, I mean, you are going to have every library is going to make up its own abstract APIs, you know, dollar something dot foo. That could be cool if it's very useful. But we always try to strive for what direction the standards are heading. So we have our own module loader, Steel, which has been around for a really long time. And recently, we removed the guts completely out of it. And that was a really tough decision. We say, hey, we have our own proprietary thing. the web may be moving in a different direction, maybe we should rethink our stuff. I know the Cujo guys had the same opinion. They actually shuttered one of their projects over the same kind of concept. We were thinking about doing the same with Steel, and we realized, hey, let's remove the guts from our proprietary loading system, and let's use something a little bit more accepted by the community. So we rebuilt Steel in the past couple years, wrapped it around System.js. So now, if you saw the demo, I was writing everything in ES6 modules in the hope that when you write this application, if you had the demo today and you wrote it in ES6 modules, then tomorrow, maybe you just remove Steel entirely and you rely on whatever is the actual underlying mechanic. So whenever we're developing our APIs, we try to at least give you something that's, it's not gonna be future-proof, but we wanna get you as close to that as we can. And we do take that stuff into consideration. I'm the same way. I like to wire things together because
code.
Yeah, I guess I like to code. We're not in the business of building, you know, small, simple, in-the-box apps. Everybody in this room is probably here because you work for a corporation that wants something very custom and very tailored to their needs in terms of branding, performance, or what widgets you're building otherwise. It's not something I would love to be able to go to every one of my clients and Google for their app and download it off the web. That never happens. So I'm in the same boat as you guys. Sorry, John. So
I'm still not very clear what's the difference between a framework and a library. Let's try and pick on one of the jQuery guys to see if they have any opinions of what's a framework, what's a library.
I think John Paul got it. Basically, I would agree that I think the degree to which something is very opinionated and limits the degrees of freedom is a good way to kind of measure the difference between a framework and a library. And I think you can look at that, like how many of you out there write applications that are primarily like consumed internally by some company rather than like a public application that everyone uses? Are there quite a few people writing internal apps? There's frameworks. I mean, if you think about it, like Excel with Excel macros, Excel is a framework for writing applications, and you write code against the spreadsheet, and it limits your degrees of freedom. So, I mean, if you look at a framework in that way, then, you know, certainly Ember does that. It does it for the effect of being able to prevent you from having to make all those decisions and hopefully guiding you to what should be the one true way of getting things done. I think there's some trade-offs in doing that, though, because then you can't mix and match. So, you know, it's the difference between a notebook PC and a desktop PC. With a desktop PC, you can put any power supply. I mean, you've got modularity. A motherboard, power supply, case, you can mix and match. But when it comes to notebook computers, you can't do that.
Interoperability goes out the window, yeah.
So when we think from a language point of view, the main difference people talk about in framework and library is a framework is basically in control, and it calls out to pieces that you extend, which you customize, and it lets you do certain things, but it is in charge of the life cycle. While in case of a library, basically you are in charge, your code is in charge of the lifecycle. It calls out to the library to do specific things. So for me, like jQuery is a library where I would call out to it to do specific things and get back.
I'm gonna blow your mind though, because what you just described is a browser, right? Like the browser is a framework and it just calls back to us and then, you know, lets us do our stuff. So the browser itself defines, the browser itself defines all sites, all sorts of limits to what we do. So I don't know. I've heard that before, and I agree with it to some extent. But you can write things that are libraries that do the same, that fire events, and that you listen for. I mean, React is not a framework, but React does many of the things you just described.
Okay.
Where the browsers and debuggers take
So can someone repeat the question so everyone can hear, and then we can...
I'll take the first if you think so.
You want to take the first question?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, good.
So what's the right IDE to be using? Well, I don't use these two, but like, if you want to be like a legit programmer, you better be using like Emacs and Vim. And like, like I personally use like Sublime Text. Yeah, I'm just like, you know, I'm a designer. Yeah, like I don't develop.
And I'm the one who doesn't like code.
I'm just saying. I still do develop. But Sublime and Atom seem to be the big ones that everybody's using. Atom's got just hit 1.0 release, and they've got a ton of awesome features. I think it's running. It used to have React in it, and it's basically completely built off web technology. So that's, if you want to be really meta, if you want to be like building websites, or you want to be writing JavaScript code in something that's running JavaScript, I would say use Atom. Brackets as well. I think if you want to like up your game, you got to go to Vim or Emacs, and then you just like constantly like...
Just Vim, not Emacs.
Okay, Vim. Whatever, man.
But where's Bodo?
Find Vim. Okay, these guys are getting on my back. But yeah, I would say that's great. But.
So the second question was about the built-in debugger tools that they have now, which are pretty advanced, especially Chrome, where you can edit things, you can map it to source on disk, and essentially you can treat that as your development environment. Well, you used to be able to do that. Now, of course, since you're transpiling to something that's Angular that goes through about 15 build steps, you can't do that anymore, right? So just about the time we got to the point where we could do what you described, which is you could take the source file on disk, and even if it's being, you know, served out through a web server, you could still edit it. Now what you're editing is essentially the compiled down, compressed, non-usable source code. And even with source maps right now, the source map spec is so primitive that there's a lot of things you can't do with it. And in fact, I mean, there's more work being done on the source map spec, but comparing it to the work that I've done, say, under Visual Studio, where they have essentially a source map, but it like 10 times better, we're nowhere near being able to do what we were just able to do before we started screwing it up. So we've got to get all the way through this whole process over again of being able to figure out, when you see a line in the debugger, you know, how does it map back to what your original source said?
Don't you think using a debugger is an anti-pattern?
That is controversial. No, I do not.
Years ago, I used to think that too. Like when there were problems, usually it would dump core, and I would look at, you know, it would say seg fault core dumped, and the most I would need to know is like where it died. And then you go back and look at the source and you'd say, well, it's gotta be somewhere here, you know, and you change it and you run it again. And, you know, 8 times out of 10, you'd be right, and the other 2 times you'd have to stare at it a little more. But no, I don't think it is an anti-pattern now. I've changed my mind.
This is a problem that WebAssembly is gonna run into as well, right? Essentially like the compiled code and source maps, like, yeah, support for debugging code.
Yeah, and there is work being done on better source maps, but it's not there yet. So we really, who knows how long it'll be before we get back to the point that we used to be at. It seemed like we were so close to Nirvana. But
well, there's still a lot of projects out there using vanilla JavaScript, no?
Kurt Cobain died early.
So close to Nirvana, but we didn't get it.
Oh, I totally get now. I was like, that was really morbid. I was like, why is he bringing up? I
knew him well. Yeah.
All right. Looks like we are almost towards the end. We could do one more question if someone has before we wrap this up and open for the keynote.
CoffeeScript. Yeah, I use CoffeeScript all the time. Oh, yeah. All the time. I'm legit, for years now, I've been using CoffeeScript. It's the best. Who likes curly braces and semicolons and all this other? Oh, get away.
I love curly braces. They're like mustaches. Oh.
Okay, I will.
We're missing the human lint, sorry.
So my personal opinion is I'm going to have to give up this battle at some point because ES6 stole a bunch of the stuff from CoffeeScript, but now it's like I had this discussion with Chris the other day. We're kidding this like weird there's this weird moment where like the transpilers and like Babel or Babel or however you say it, it's still, I can't write code that's beautiful. And since I like stylus and I like CoffeeScript, that's the way I usually go. But yeah, TypeScript and Babel and all those, I don't know. I'm not a big fan.
I think TypeScript will be, the TypeScript team has already said that they're aiming to merge into ES7 or whenever they can get them together. And ES7 has already got a type proposal, don't they?
Yeah.
So, you know, the idea is eventually to migrate those to one true JavaScript. It just will take time. And I like the idea of having an optional type system. I think it really would help, even if not as much at runtime, it will help runtime, but just to help us as programmers understand what's expected, it helps self-document.
So I've used TypeScript only a little bit, and what IDEs can do with it is amazing, and I found that to be very useful. And also working on teams with many former either Java or C# developers, it was very useful, but
yeah.
I haven't done.
So precisely because of my experience with Java and C# development, I think it's a bad idea, actually. The types of
I guess I don't swing either way. I'm going to quote Jeremy a little bit when he was talking about CoffeeScript when it first came out. Just be aware of the different approaches between CoffeeScript and TypeScript. I remember when CoffeeScript was first launched, the big point Jeremy was making is this is a different syntax, but in terms of features of the language, this is a one-to-one comparison with JavaScript. There's nothing they're adding additionally in CoffeeScript. Now with TypeScript, they are adding a few different features. Dave was completely correct. You know, there are going to, you know, there's the potential for a lot of TypeScript to be merged into the next versions of JavaScript down the road. But just be aware right now what the focuses of each are kind of are. I'm a big fan of Ruby, so CoffeeScript does look really attractive to me. That being said, I write in ES6 anyways, so, but I feel like I like it. So.
Yeah, like, I have so many opinions on this. This is terrible. Features and just compile to JavaScript. So I feel like ES5 is fine, and I feel like that we're essentially going to hit this block where we just have to keep transpiling all of our code anyways because you want to still support older browsers, or we're going to be in the next like 2 or 3 years. And it's a hard limit because it's like syntactical changes to the language, which is an issue. You can't just polyfill that. You can't just be like, do we have this API? We can't do feature detection for ES6 and like piecemeal out your code. It's not like that. So we're hitting this place where if you want to use like Babel or you want to use all the cool stuff in ES6, like there's this hard limit on the browsers that it'll support. And then we're doing transpiling down to ES5. So I consider basically use whatever you want as far as TypeScript, CoffeeScript, whatever you want, but just know that you're still shipping ES5, which I consider to be like, you know, feature complete.
Yeah. Otherwise, you'll end up like the Python community with Python 2 and Python 3000. And like, I think there are still a lot more Python 2.7 programmers than
Python 3 programmers, even though it's been like, I don't know, four years? I may be wrong, right? I mean, so there's, with so ES7, I feel there might be a schism in the community.
Just a quick show of hands, how many people would like Java to be more strongly typed?
JavaScript, you mean?
JavaScript, sorry.
Yeah.
Java is already, yeah.
Java's too weak. Java's too weak.
Quick show of hands, how many people would like that? That's
great. You should check out your script.
That's
you can
nice
do strongly
plug.
Type JavaScript right now.
So I kind of saw about 30% of the people put up their hands, and about 70% of the people feel that it should be weakly typed and dynamically typed.
I think the question you need to ask is, how many of you are ambivalent or don't have an opinion?
Not having opinions is also an option.
No, that's because they can get into the gradual typing camp or use something like flow and decorate your existing code with types, and that's going to get stripped off.
So I think if people come from a Java background or a C# background or any of these things, seeing a weakly typed, dynamically typed language like JavaScript or PHP or one of these is very liberating. But I was just kind of getting a sense of how many people had an opinion on that.
So it's not liberating, but it's concerning and throws you off completely off the road.
It's the Wild West, man. It's like, do whatever you want.
realize too, even, so I was a .NET developer for a long time. In .NET 3.5, you got the var keyword.
Yeah.
So even in Java 8, you now have dynamic variables as well. It's still type safe, but they're starting to loosen some of these restrictions as well. So I think even we're talking about a convergence between the frameworks and our approaches to web development, there's a slight convergence between the languages too. Language maintainers are being less dogmatic and seeing, hey, what features are working in functional languages, and functional languages are saying, hey, what behaviors are working in the strongly typed languages, and we're all starting to borrow ideas from each other. So there's nobody's found like the one language. There's not going to be a winner out of this either.
PHP.
It's just what works.
Yeah. PHP for sure.
PHP is already there, man. It's a winner. All right, I'm going to take this in a different direction now. All right, I think we are about 10 minutes early, but we'll kind of try and close this panel. Oh, sorry, Scott had.
I have a highly technical question.
Is this a quiz?
Yes, for all of you.
Uh-oh. Right. I already failed that quiz out there. I got 60%, and apparently the bar was 80%. And 60%, I only got two questions wrong, and they tricked me. They changed the wording on the first question. I'm not sure.
And now we all know.
I know.
All right, Scott, shoot it.
Thoughts on comma first, optional semicolons, tabs for spaces.
How do you feel about clubbing baby seals?
Oh, is this a Canadian like thing? Is it an attack at my?
It's a personal attack.
And one bar.
So I do have an opinion on all of those things.
What was
the last one?
All
right, let's go one by one, right? The first one, Scott.
First one. So comma first.
Comma first, no. One var, no. Semicolon, yes for everything my own, typically whatever the author of whatever I'm working with does. And what was the fourth one?
Tabs for spaces.
Oh, man, I'm all spaces. I do not understand. I'm all spaces.
Spaces.
I'm spaces.
So sorry, say that one more time. So
it was one var, tab spaces?
No. Tabs, spaces, yes. Semicolons? Yeah, no way, man. I don't even have var, man. CoffeeScript. but if I was doing it, it'd be, okay, yeah, one var, no. Semicolons, yes, if I'm actually writing JavaScript.
Comma first?
Comma first, no. What was the last one?
That's it. You think you hit all four?
Yeah, well, I'm going to need somebody to walk me through these two. Comma first, no. Semicolons, yes. What was it? Tab spaces. Tabs. Spaces are 2 bytes.
What?
Spaces are 2 bytes and tabs are 1.
My Dropbox is so full because of all that.
What was the other one? It was four, right? Was it
one bar?
One bar. Oh, I'm kind of indifferent. The biggest thing I would say in all those is be consistent, because if you mix and match, then it's terrible.
Yeah, or a double versus single quotes. Oh man, that kills me.
Oh, double quotes, always double quotes.
What?
Yeah.
Whoa, no way.
Okay. I'm always double semicolon to make sure.
Yeah. Double versus single quotes, now that we have backticks.
Yeah, exactly. For template strings, now you are.
You gotta go double quotes.
I know, but I only use double quotes when I'm doing HTML, like the actual strings. Yeah.
All right, so one bar, no. Semicolons, yes. Tabs versus spaces, and what is the last one?
Comma first.
Yeah.
Oh, wow, you're comma first?
Yeah.
That's surprising.
Do you guys know who got comma first into JavaScript? It was Ryan Dahl.
Oh, really?
I did not know that.
Where's he now?
New York represent, I had no idea.
He bought us comma first and then ran away.
Notice he hasn't been in the community in a while. Somebody took
him out. We invited him, but he kind of was scared of this question, so he did not show up. All right, do you guys want to take that answer as well? All three.
All of us?
Wait, editor config is your answer, basically.
Editor. Yeah, ESLint RC.
We might all have the same answer. So one var, no. Semicolons, yes. Tabs, of course.
Of course.
And definitely not comma first.
Error high five.
And the way that you normalize all this is you get editor config for the tabs for sure. And
colon retab. That's for the users.
All right, cool. I think we'll take a quick break. There is coffee already being served out.